This is movie night. Hello and welcome to Movie Night, YouTube's number one movie review show. I'm your host, Paula, Jonathan Paula. Tonight, in honor of the 23rd James Bond picture, we'll be reviewing five of my personal favorites from each of the Bond eras, excluding George Lazenby because, well, no one really cared for him much. Kicking off our five-pack of 007 reviews, let's discuss Goldfinger. The third chapter of the James Bond saga was released in September of 1964 and quickly recouped its, at the time, impressive $3 million budget, eventually grossing 122 more. Directing his first of four Bond pictures, Guy Hamilton takes us along for the adventure in this playful, exciting, and action-packed adaptation of Ian Fleming's novel of the same name. Hardly a high-octane action film by today's standards, this adeptly made spy caper still excites almost 50 years later. Finally reaching full stride with the character, Sean Connery, in his most famous role, takes on the lead character of MI6 agent 007 with swagger, confidence, and charm, seducing no less than three ladies during this 110-minute picture. In this memorable installment, I vividly remember watching numerous times during my youth on annual basic cable marathons, Bond is pitted against the money-hungry Ulrich Goldfinger, a deliciously devious villain who has no issues killing his own guys to get the gold, both literally and figuratively. Goldfinger aims to rob America's largest gold depository in Fort Knox, and Her Majesty's best 00 agent is tasked by Bernard Lee as M to stop him. Besides being a genuinely entertaining, campy 60s flick, Goldfinger was, by all accounts, a pioneering effort, especially in respects to the second highest grossing film franchise of all time, introducing such great staples like the extended cold open action sequence, the Q character, who counters Bond's whimsical behavior with new gadgets and exposition, the lush and beautiful Bond girls, featured here with great tongue-in-cheek names like Tilly Masterson and Pussy Galore, the quirky sidekick villain who always gets in the hero's way, and the villain's overly elaborate method of execution, served up moments after explaining away his entire nefarious plot.
I think you've made your point, Goldfinger. Thank you for the demonstration.
Choose your next witticism carefully, Mr. Bond. It may be your last. The purpose of our two previous encounters is now very clear to me. I do not intend to be distracted by another. Good night, Mr. Bond.
Do you expect me to talk?
No, Mr. Bond, I expect you to die. There is nothing you can talk to me about that I don't already know.
The acting from the all-star cast isn't Oscar-worthy, but considering the outlandish subject material in some sequences, it's more than believable. While it's important to judge a film's technical and visual achievements based on the time period it was created, Goldfinger curiously features jerky, sped-up footage and unnecessary projection screen shots, which unfortunately cheapen an otherwise adeptly made motion picture. On the flip side, however, the sound mix was great enough to score the Bond franchise its first Academy Award, which of course is supported by the terrific and instantly iconic James Bond theme by composer Monty Norman. Perhaps slow by today's standards, this film still moves along at a brisk pace, from one set piece to the next. From Bond catching Goldfinger cheating on the golf course, to him using his Aston Martin's ejector seat to rid himself of an uninvited henchman. Far too often, though, Bond is relegated to a bystander role, as he spends nearly half the film taking orders from his captors, leaving him more like a patsy witnessing the action rather than a secret agent involved in it. One curious plot point I noticed, though, why does Goldfinger waste so much time, money, and energy building scale models and flip-away pool tables to explain his involved heist to his financial backers, only to gas the bad guy convention moments later? A terrifically fun scene, but one that makes zero sense in context. A few years earlier, Dr. No brought Fleming's idealistic British agent to the big screen, but this thrilling and amusing picture was clearly the high watermark for Connery's six-film involvement. Goldfinger, unadulterated, inventive excitement, quintessential Bond. Well, those are my thoughts on Goldfinger. Now let's see what you had to say about this picture in the YouTube comments. The Rate-O-Matic now to rank both my score and the audience's for Goldfinger. A 10 and a 9. Praising it as iconic, classic, and flawless, you clearly hold this film in high regard, rating it as amazing. Aging well and defining many of the trademark Bond elements for decades to come, it's hard to fault this film, but I'm still not convinced it deserves the highest score. I thought it was awesome, though. Moving from the 60s to the 70s, our second Bond film tonight is The Spy Who Loved Me. Released on 7/7/77, this would be the 10th spy adventure film in the James Bond series, and the third starring Roger Moore, the franchise's longest-serving leading man. Directing his second 007 movie, Lewis Gilbert seems curiously afraid of the close-up in this picture, with nearly all of the static shots existing as loose medium or completely wide shots. Inherently, it was the style of the time and makes the exciting action set pieces easy to follow, but watching this movie for the first time in its native 2-to-1 aspect ratio was a jarringly distant experience for me. The most expensive Bond picture produced at the time was nominated for 3 Oscars and grossed $185 million worldwide. The plot follows Bond reluctantly working alongside his Russian counterpart, Agent Triple X, during the height of the Cold War, to locate and recover 2 missing nuclear submarines. Finally developing his own playful and tongue-in-cheek style, Moore is convincing as a suave and flirtatious Bond, but he almost seems afraid to get his hands dirty at times, a stark contrast to the character's portrayal by later actors. More than capable of holding her own, future wife of Ringo star Barbara Bach does a great job in the action sequences, but her rigid acting and puzzled delivery makes many of the slower scenes awkward to watch, even if she does routinely distract with revealing outfits. German actor Kurt Jurgen stars as the sadistic villain who is hell-bent on an atomic war between the East and the West that'll make his underwater ocean paradise, unoriginally named Atlantis, the only hope of the human race. This ridiculous and tired scheme would be shamelessly rehashed just a couple years later in the even more comical Moonraker. I will say one thing though, the absurdist nature of this premise, coupled by the campy disco-themed score by Marvin Hamlisch, is what makes these goofier 70s-era Bond films all the more enjoyable. One of the few themes not to be named after the film itself, Carly Simon's Nobody Does It Better is a true classic, even earning an Academy Award nomination. Jurgens barely shares 60 seconds of screen time with Moore in a forgettable role that ends anticlimactically. Luckily, the number 2 baddie, a 7-foot-tall henchman with steel teeth known as Jaws, gives Bond a run for his money. The stubborn, mute brute plays cat and mouse with our hero every step of the way, making for some thrilling and intimate combat scenes. Opening with a spectacular downhill ski chase in the Austrian Alps, The Spy Who Loved Me features some impressive, memorable, and huge battle scenes. Unfortunately, it also slows to a near standstill to dish out much of its heavy and long-winded exposition in the early scenes. The locations are exotic, the costumes fun and revealing, and the gadgets are uber cool. From the ski pole gun to the portable jet ski, to arguably the best car in the series' illustrious franchise, the fully submersible Lotus Esprit, which Bond adeptly uses to outrun evil scuba divers with onboard torpedoes, landmines, and surface-to-air missiles.
Swim.
At 2 hours and 5 minutes, this spy adventure begins to feel a bit long in the tooth by the final curtain. But for all its quirks, pacing issues, boring cinematography, and stale acting, The Spy Who Loved Me is still largely ridiculous, but unquestionably fun. Now that you've heard my review, let's check out some of the YouTube comments for some of yours. Here's a Rate-O-Matic, an 8 and a 7 for The Spy Who Loved Me. You enjoyed the campy fun quality to it and praised the iconic Jaws character, as well as the attractive Bond chick. You thought this was a great film. I was more reserved. This film certainly has not aged well, and is perhaps better suited for younger audiences, as the whole thing feels a bit silly now. But it's still a fun time to watch every now and then. I thought it was cool. Third up tonight is License to Kill. The 16th James Bond film was released in June of 1989, and although it made $156 million, 5 times its budget, it has the unfortunate distinction of being the least financially successful entry of the entire series. Directing his 5th Bond film of the decade, John Glenn's PG-13 treatment here would be the first for 007, painting the picture in a decidedly more realistic and darker tone than the almost playful nature of Moore's 7 films. Starring in his second and ultimately last picture as the character, Timothy Dalton stars as MI6's Crown Agent, whose determination and seriousness guides him on his personal vendetta to avenge his CIA buddy, Felix Leiter. After a nefarious Latin American drug lord, Robert Davi, brutally mutilates him by literally feeding him to the sharks. Remarking to his henchmen that loyalty is more important to me than money, Davi's sinister portrayal of the villain is downright frightening at times. This guy has no issue murdering his own men in cold blood, looking them right in the eye when he does it too. Going off mission, Bond's boss, M, is forced to revoke his famous license to kill, leaving Bond seemingly on his own to thwart the bad guys.
You have an assignment. And I expect you to carry it out objectively and professionally.
Then you have my resignation, sir.
We're not a country club, 007. Effective immediately. Your license to kill is revoked.
I guess it's a farewell to arms.
Ah!
After opening with a thrilling mid-air takedown sequence over Miami that is remarkably similar to the cold open of The Dark Knight Rises, this film settles into a steady and well-paced rhythm that feels more like a generic 80s action thriller than a familiar Bond spy caper. In some ways, though, the picture is all the better for it. Even the rigid acting of Talia Soto, one of the two nearly indistinguishable Bond girls, can't ruin the fun. Carrie Lowell plays the other girl, who luckily for Bond has no issue flying planes and kicking ass, even if she does start to bicker like a whiny high schooler when she discovers Bond has become romantically involved with both of them. And luckily for us, they're both easy on the eyes during many of their numerous costume changes. Recognizable names like Benicio del Toro and Wayne Newton, yes, that Wayne Newton, show up here in limited supporting roles, who deliver amusingly devilish and smarmy performances, respectively. Although he doesn't appear until the halfway mark, Desmond Llewellyn stars as the venerable gadget guy, Q, in his largest of 17 appearances, assisting Bond in the field. At 133 minutes, this picture is littered with cool gadgets and clever escape sequences, including one of my all-time personal favorites, where Bond narrowly avoids underwater death by harpooning and then water skiing behind a seaplane mid-takeoff. The iconic theme music swells during all the right moments, and the tension during Bond's undercover sequences is impressive for a franchise that has been more about flash than substance. The overall scope and consequence here is lacking, however, with Bond tearing through enemies, drugs, and money for a petty revenge quest that honestly seems beneath the character. And for a more realistic picture, Bond pulling a wheelie in a tanker truck to avoid a huge gas fire just seems ridiculous. A grittier and more personal affair, fans of Roger Moore might feel out of place here, but I thought License to Kill was a taut thriller, lacking Bond feel. Now that you've heard my review, let's check out some of the YouTube comments for some of yours. License to Kill on the Radomatic, a 7 and an 8. Reviews were mixed for Dalton's Bond. Some people are put off by his starkly different portrayal of 007, while others, myself included, feel his contributions to the series were vastly underrated. You thought this film was cool. I love the action and the revenge plot, but just wish more could have been done in a lot of places. There was something decidedly missing from this film, but I thought it was great. Now let's talk about Netflix. If you're watching this show, it's a safe bet you love movies, and chances are you'd also love getting them instantly streamed directly to your PC, Mac, tablet, phone, PlayStation, or Xbox using Netflix. Help support Movie Night, and please consider grabbing yourself a free 30-day trial membership by visiting netflix.com/jogwheel and sign up tonight. Okay, now let's review GoldenEye. Although it immediately followed License to Kill, a legal battle resulted in a 6-year hiatus between these films, the longest gap ever in Bond's 50-year history. When the 17th 007 picture finally made its way to the screen in November of 1995, though, we were treated to an overhauled, modernized Bond universe with all new lead actors in most of the familiar roles. Most notably, of course, Pierce Brosnan as Commander Bond, and Judi Dench as M. The two veteran actors share a cold and intense conversation early in the film that expertly establishes their frosty but respectful relationship. After his friend and fellow Agent 006, played by Hollywood redshirt Sean Bean, is executed during a Cold War mission gone bad, Brosnan finds himself hunting down the thief of an EMP satellite weapon known as GoldenEye, who just so happens to be the same Russian evildoer who killed his friend 9 years prior. Director Martin Campbell effortlessly adapts this series for the 90s, which in a post-Soviet world many thought ill-advised. The script, a holdover from the Dalton days, still has a dark tinge to it, and is all the more better for it. GoldenEye is arguably the strongest of Brosnan's four pictures, which became decidedly more playful and unbelievable as they progressed. Brosnan blends the best comedic elements that Moore pioneered with the sexiness and determination Connery introduced, giving us the quintessential action hero in the process. The
trick is to quit while you're still a kid.
That's one trick I've never learned. Perhaps you'll show me how it's done. Vodka martini. Shaken, not stirred. And for you?
The same.
How do you take it?
Straight up. With a twist. Thank you, Mr.
The name's Bond. James Bond.
Xenia Sergeyevna Onatop.
Onatop?
Onatop.
The film opens with a spectacular cold open that introduces us to the new Bond, as he bungee jumps off a 700-foot dam in the Soviet Union and sneaks into a weapons facility, before setting some bombs and narrowly escaping by driving a motorcycle off a cliff to catch a falling airplane. Why he doesn't just rappel off the dam is another question. It's a hell of a way to kick off the film, a well-written sequence that'll instantly remind any 90s kids of the classic facility level from the iconic N64 video game. Isabella Scaroppo is a fine Russian Bond girl, but her portrayal is mostly overshadowed by the great performances around her, like the femme fatale that flirtatiously plays cat and mouse with Bond, Famke Janssen. She's one of the standout female baddies in this series, and she manages to be menacing and seductive at the same time. For his contribution as 006, Sean Bean is an absolute pro, equally matched to Bond's skills and talent. He is an excellent foe that's a pleasure to watch. As a bonus, he also lives up to his humorous internet memedom by getting himself killed not once, but twice, both instances done here incredibly well. Relying more on models than CGI, the visuals here are gritty and realistic, the explosions loud and gigantic, the sound editing layered and coherent. Grossing six times its $58 million budget, this well-paced 130-minute action film truly hits all the right marks of a Bond film. The girls, gadgets, car chases, card games, and drinks. Feeling at times, though, like a paint-by-numbers adventure more than anything else. GoldenEye. Formulaic execution, but memorable thrills. Now let's see what you had to say about Bond 17 in the YouTube comments. GoldenEye on the Rate-O-Matic, a 9 and an 8. You praise Sean Bean as the bad guy here, who did a tremendous job fighting Bond at every step. You thought this was an awesome film. Almost serving as a 90s reboot for the franchise, I love the action, hand-to-hand combat, tank chase through Russia, and everything else here, even if it wasn't particularly original. I thought this was a great film. And finally tonight, the brand new release from Eon Productions, Skyfall. Sam Mendes directs this modern yet stylistically old-fashioned motion picture, released 50 years after the pilot entry, Dr. No premiered in October of 1962. At 143 minutes, the 23rd James Bond picture is also the series' longest, but quite frankly, it's also the best paced. Never is there a dull moment, from the pulse-pounding dirt bike and train chase that opens the film, to a harrowing escape inside London's famed Tube. Impeccably beautiful in every shot, nine-time Oscar nominee for cinematography Roger Deakins expertly uses harsh lighting, dark shadows, and bright colors, filling every frame with tremendously gorgeous imagery. Much has been said for Daniel Craig's portrayal of 007. While his first two entries successfully rebooted the franchise for the 21st century, they were decidedly lacking many of the traditional Bond elements. Gone were the gadgets, humor, and bombastic theme song. Quantum of Solace was a frantic mess and an unfortunate disappointment. Luckily, Skyfall has returned to form, in more ways than one, including several humorous callbacks to past entries in the timeless series. No longer the invincible secret agent we know and love, Bond is clearly vulnerable and weaker here, which, although off-character for the series, creates a good deal of tension and suspense in many key scenes. Presumed dead following a mission gone wrong, a beaten-down and worn-out Craig finds himself forced back into action when MI6 headquarters are attacked and M's life is threatened. In her largest role to date, Judi Dench's steadfast and seasoned portrayal of Bond's boss is captivating to watch. The film script and much of the dialogue almost seems self-aware, with many references to the good old days of the Cold War and traditional espionage. As the blonde-haired weirdo hell-bent on revenge, Javier Bardem's creepy and chilling delivery creates one of the more memorable Bond villains to date.
I won't miss next time, Mr. Silver.
Not bad, James, for a physical wreck.
Why? Thank you.
You got me. Now, here's your prize. It's called radio.
I do hope that wasn't for me.
No. But that is.
Despite some fascinating developments with both, neither of the Bond girls receive any significant portion of the screen time, with Bond focusing most of his attention on the motherly M. Making a triumphant return to the series is Bond's snarky quartermaster, with the role of Q now being played by Ben Whishaw, in what we can only hope is the first of many movies for him. Although he doesn't provide Bond with many fancy gadgets, their playful relationship keeps things light. In most other scenes, however, Craig's attempts at quick puns and one-liners seems to fall flat. This serious version of Bond might just not be cut out for humor. Curiously withholding the iconic gun barrel sequence for the end credits, this film's cold open is a remarkably exciting 12 minutes of action, tension, and emotion. And while the film never quite returns to that high point, the remainder of the film certainly isn't lacking. The grand finale is a beautifully choreographed siege in northern Scotland that is a treat to watch, even if it feels a touch anticlimactic and drawn out. But for its few flaws, this is a delightfully fast, thrilling, and thankfully, Bond-esque adventure many fans of 007 will enjoy. Skyfall. Brilliant execution, irresistibly entertaining Bond. Now that you've heard my opening day review, let's read some of yours from the YouTube comments.
Mm-hmm.
Let's rate Skyfall, a 9. Many praise the action and emotional resonance of this film, which plays things a bit closer to the chest. You thought it was awesome. Time will tell if this goes down as the best Bond yet, but it is definitely up there, even if certain elements feel forced, and Bardem's second act escape sequence feels awfully similar to the Joker's in The Dark Knight. I thought this was an awesome film too. Now it's time to read your reviews for other films currently playing in theaters, with some of your tweet critiques. If you see a movie in theaters, make sure to submit your Twitter review using the JPMN hashtag to have it featured on the show. You might have heard we just had a big election here in America, so next week's theme is presidents. We'll be reviewing the 1993 Ivan Reitman comedy Dave, the Aaron Sorkin penned The American President from 1995, and lastly, Steven Spielberg's Lincoln, which is released nationwide on November 16th. Let me know what you think about these movies by voting in the polls below or by leaving a comment review. And don't forget to check out the Movie Night Archive for an organized library of every review to date. Once again, my name is Jonathan Paula. Thank you for watching Movie Night. I hope to see you right back here next Friday.